Archives of Prasar Bharati presents the timeless treasure of golden era.
Professor Jefferson was the senior most neurosurgeon of the United Kingdom in those days. He's a great surgeon, scientist and philosopher. He had already 7 or 8 trainees under him, all these post-war, war-returned surgeons who were being trained. So he suggested that you may not get much chance to operate here. So you go and work with Mr. Robotham, who is the chief in Newcastle. He has got a big department and you will learn a lot. Of course, when a man like Jefferson's status advises, you take it. Then I went to Newcastle and there was a big unit. It was 84 beds for neurosurgery. And he had only one senior assistant, one Mr. Wally, and only 2 house surgeons and one more, 1-2 anesthetists, that's all. And that area of the UK was treating all the neurosurgical cases in northeast of England and southern Scotland. A very busy unit. So
that means neurosurgery was well established in...
In England at that time, of course.
Any other countries?
For instance, Sweden was one of the very advanced countries in neurosurgery at that time. Canada, United States, England was quite advanced in those days. France, Switzerland and Sweden.
But the concept was still new.
Concept was new and Germany also had started. So it was a lucky thing that I went to Newcastle because within a few days, because I was already a master of surgery in general surgery and FRCS and had enormous experience of operating. Not like modern MS general surgery who don't have so much opportunity to operate and learn. So they could see within a few days that I was quite capable of handling patients. And within a month and a half, I learned all the techniques and they allowed me to open the skull, close the skull. And by August, I was able to do everything myself. So Mr. Robotham was a visionary. He was already planning a big institute in Newcastle, which is now existent now. It's one of the best units in the United Kingdom, is the Newcastle, which was planned by Mr. Robotham. And the days were very long because we had 3 or 4 major cases a day. And in the winter, once I went into the operating room by 8 or 8.30, we used to come out only at 7 or 8 in the evening. And so never saw the sunlight for 4 or 5 days together, daylight. And after that, we had to examine patients, write the case sheets, and some days attend the outpatient. It was a very good training, and both in head injuries as well as in brain tumors. But as I would refer later, the techniques of diagnosis were still rather primitive. We had to make a hole and put some air into the brain, oxygen. Then take X-ray pictures. Then we know where the tumor was. There was no CT scan or even thing called angiogram. This angiogram is a technique where we put a needle into the artery in the neck and then inject dye and then take X-ray pictures.
Similar to the heart.
Same thing. Actually, cerebral angiogram came much earlier than coronary angiogram. And I went to Manchester to learn the technique and introduce it in Newcastle. That is one of the credits for me in Newcastle.
Did it pose any threats to life?
Angiogram, no. But ventriculogram, that is putting in air into the brain, had a 8% mortality. That is, the test itself had mortality. So the technique was put in the air early in the morning by 7, take the X-ray pictures, get everything ready by 8.30 or 9 and start operating immediately if there is a tumor. Because if you do the test earlier and leave the patient alone, he may die. So it has to be the diagnosis should be followed on immediately by surgery.
And what if there's no tumor?
There's no tumor, then there's no harm because the air will get absorbed and we'll give the proper medicine for whatever lesion it was. But 80% of cases, there will be a tumor because you already have diagnosed intracranial pressure and it has to be caused by something, either tumor or water. If it is water, it is easy to drain. It is tumor, you have got to remove it. By August, that is in 8 months, they had so much of confidence in me that both my chief and his assistant, both went on leave and left me in charge of the department from 1st August 31st. And in this time, I go back again because we are talking of August, 15th August, because two incidents happened on 2/15th August. One is the first 15th August 1947, when we got independence. I was in Edinburgh doing my FRCS, and we had a big meeting of Indians. And to my great surprise, there were almost 1,000 Edinburgh citizens attending our meeting and cheering us that we got independence. When we get Mahatma Gandhi, everybody stood up, and Gandhi was a sacred name in Britain. Even in Britain, mind you, in Edinburgh, when they gave us independence, when they had given us power, handed over, still they were celebrating with us. An Indian was a very highly respected figure in 1947 in the UK. I was respected as an Indian. So the 1 year in Newcastle went off very quickly. In the meantime, Mr. Robotham arranged for me to visit Sweden, because Sweden was a very leading center in neurosurgery. One professor, Oliver Krona, he was the lord of all Europe in neurosurgery. So I spent some time with him, learned some new techniques. And then we attended one international conference in Paris, again as Mr. Robotham. And he also made me the member of the British Neurosurgical Society. As early as in my training, he already made me a member, because he said, you are quite competent to be a member.
Were you the only Indian member?
Yeah, at that time. Today, I am the oldest member of that society, because I was made a member in 1949. And at the end of the year, Indira came to England. She joined me. And in the new year, they have got one custom of what's called first footing in European homes. The first person to enter the house must have a dark hair. That is not a blonde, but a brunette. So this time I was much in demand, because I had a lot of hair then, not like now. And so we were invited, and we did first footing in 2-3 houses. And each house, of course, they give you some wine and cake, and very pleasant. And I left for Montreal, Canada, in the first week of January, and spent 5 months in Montreal. The journey from Southampton to New York, it was one of the biggest ships called Mauritania, was terrible. The Atlantic gale, 5 days all of us were sick. When they touched New York, it was a different world. But when we returned in July, the Atlantic was like glass. Not even a ripple was seen from New York to Southampton. Very, very strange Atlantic it was. And most neurosurgeons in those days were aggressive personalities. First of all, they became neurosurgeons because they had the aggressive personality. And the circumstances of brain surgery in those days, one should try to comprehend. The patients came to the doctor at a very late stage, when the pressure on the brain was very high, and the tools of diagnosis were not many, and diagnosis itself, in some cases, rather uncertain. So when we operate, the brain is under great pressure. Of course, the anesthetist tries to help, but in those days, very often, the intracranial pressure was so high that the brain will just bulge out of the skull the moment you open, and even a small mistake of a millimeter or two, could cause the function like eyesight or the power of a limb or hearing or even the thinking power. All these may be damaged in the patient. So everybody was tense, and if the assistant makes even a minor error, the neurosurgeon used to be terribly upset because of the problem. But now, of course, things are entirely changed.
Has that made you less aggressive?
Oh, very much. Very much so, because the diagnosis is absolutely certain now. The techniques of surgery are so precise that today the results of surgery depend only on the skill of the surgeon, not on any extraneous factor. See, if something depends on an extraneous factor, then you are uncertain, then you get angry, then you get upset. But if you know that everything depends only on your skill, then you do a job calmly, what we call in yoga, you see, relaxed concentration. That is yoga. So you do it perfectly well. But in those days, things are so difficult, and results depended on other factors. That's why these neurosurgeons, most of them I met, were aggressive. And I am told by my various students today that I was also very aggressive.
So I noticed the past tense was, not is.
No. Because as I told you now, we have learned new techniques, and naturally the temper also cools when you have got better techniques, because you are not fighting against odds.
Are your subordinates afraid of you?
Oh, I hope they were scared of me when they were working with me. But I do think, because I heard them talk later on, many of them are professors all over this country and in the USA, Australia. And in some meetings, they will always say, we were so scared of the chief. But such sort of a discipline was essential, and that is what has made us into the good teachers we are. So, in a way, though it was not actually meant to be really a discipline procedure, it has helped. That sort of milieu in which you work. In fact, in my department, I have a photograph of a person crossing from one mountain to the other on a rope, and the caption below is, "The man who cannot afford to make a mistake." So every day I used to make my house surgeons and myself also go and look at that photograph for a minute, imbibe the spirit, and then do the work, because you cannot in brain surgery afford to make a mistake.
Doctor, you had made a previous statement saying that it's only the aggressive kind of person who can become a neurosurgeon. Why do you say that?
Generally so. You see, surgeons are of a different personality. Actually, this is mentioned even in the ancient Vedic texts in India, of people who become surgeons, people who become physicians. Of course, in those days, the surgeons were much wiser, the physicians were the wise people, the philosophers, whereas the surgeons were the ones who active, you see, who had to do something with their hands. And in those days, naturally, people who did anything with the hand was considered inferior. Only fellow who sat on his haunches and thought was supposed to be superior. I am talking of many centuries ago. And
that doesn't hold good
that
now.
That doesn't hold, certainly not hold with neurosurgeons. Because the neurosurgeon is very peculiar, because he has to be a neurologist and know the intricacies of the functioning of the brain. It's not like any other surgeon where it is only a question of repair. The function of the organ itself is not very complicated. Whereas in the brain, the most complicated organ. So when you deal with that, you must know something about it. And so medical neurology becomes very important.
There are a few people I know who are neurologists as well as neurosurgeons.
Yes.
Is it essential to take a degree, postgraduate degree in
both?
Not essential.
But the neurosurgeon should have an excellent grounding in basic neurological sciences and in clinical neurology, so that he doesn't make any error in diagnosis and he is on his own when he is operating. So he must be an excellent neurophysiologist. So these are the things that add to the zest of the profession and also to the better care of the patient. Both are involved in this. More knowledge the surgeon has, the better is the result going to be. Apart from his, of course, skill. Skill is very important. Then coming to Professor Vogt, what I would like to mention here is, Professor Vogt thought that by examining the structure of the brain and knowing it, he can predict the character of a person. That was his theory. By analyzing the number of cells, how they are distributed, where they are distributed, how they are connected. He started work in 1917. I went to him in 1950. He was already 85 and his wife was 80. But still they were working hard. They had PhD students working with them. And this idea that structure determines function was very prominent in those days. And he had been called by the communists to do the postmortem on Lenin, and he had kept Lenin's brain. He had made 600 sections. He showed them to me, showed Lenin's brain to me, and also brains of famous artists, philosophers, criminals. He had about 70 brains like that, with all the history. But then he could not prove in his lifetime that there was enough correlation. But now we know, of course, that it is not the structure that determines, but the chemicals that activate the structure. It is not the wires that connect the generator that does it. It is the current that goes through. Similarly, the current that initiates the brain is the chemical.
When you say chemicals, what do you mean?
You see, the brain is an electrochemical organ. It works by electricity and by chemistry. Electricity creates chemicals. Chemicals create electricity. Like this, they alternate. So if the chemical structure, they are called neuromessengers. the small protein molecules. If they get altered, your mood changes. If they get altered, you become a psychiatric person.
Which means you don't have really any control over the chemicals.
You have. You can, by physical exercise, by other techniques, for instance, yoga. Yoga can alter the chemistry of the brain. We have proved it in our own experiments in Madras and in Delhi.
No, that is with a conscious effort.
Yeah. So, or drugs, by giving drugs.
No, which means that if you are, you know, a case for a psychiatrist, that means something happens which is beyond your control.
Quite right. It is absolutely beyond your control.
So it could be genetic?
Most often it is genetic. You are right. Today, in the last decade, it is more and more proved that genetic influences are the ones that alter the chemistry. That we knew in our ancient, they said, purva janmam, janmam, genetic. What you have done previously affects you. So it was a guess, but now it is a proof. So this is the basis of the chemical activity of the brain. Now we know it, but Professor Vogt did not know that. And we had a very lovely time and then returned to India in October 1950. The atmosphere here was, you know, mixed atmosphere. There are many teachers of mine who welcomed me and said, now we must start this new specialty. But there are many others who are jealous. What is this young fellow? I was only how much? 28. And wanting to create a, what is this? We never operated on the brain. How can you fellow operate on the brain? This is common for every generation. I'm not blaming anybody. But as Tyagaraja said in his Kirtana, in this Pancharatna Kirtana, Yandaro Mahanubhavalu Andariki Vandanamu. There are so many Mahanubhavas at that time who made the starting of neurosurgery possible. I must mention here Dr. R. V. Rajam, who was a very great venereologist, physician, and he was the dean of our college, who lived up to 100 years and died recently, a great man. Then there was Colonel Sangam Lal, who was the professor of surgery. See, which professor will allow an upstart young fellow to do a completely new specialty and give him bed in his wards? But Sangam Lal did it. In fact, I have written a chapter on Sangam Lal, the magnanimous colonel. When I went to see him as professor of surgery, sir, this is what I would like to do. He said, fine. Other surgeons wanted to take me as their assistant and they will operate, it seems, and then I have to assist. How can you do that? Because neurosurgery was an entirely new technique. And he not only asked his assistants to help me, he gave 4 beds of his own beds to, for me to admit my patients, and allowed me to operate by myself after he finished his list. By 2 or 3, they will finish their operation list. After that, I used to start. In those days, the nurses, ward boys, assistants, they were all very helpful. They didn't have the idea of closing the whole shop at 2 o'clock, going home, or go on strike. No such thing was there.
Dedication was
much more there. This is independence. I don't know whether it has created anything, but it has destroyed commitment. So I used to stand outside in the corridor at 3 p.m. and whoever assistant was going by, I used to call him, hey, come and assist. Help. The other story is there was no suction apparatus. You see, brain, you've got to use suction to take the blood off when you're operating. So there was an old DC motor, which I must also mention here, Dr. Munuswamy, Captain Munuswamy, was surgical registrar. He's a great man. He became a professor of surgery in Andhra, and he took the trouble of bringing this DC motor and bringing it to the operating room. And when you switch it on, the whole thing will go dug, 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 like that. The whole first floor of the general hospital used to tremble. So from that time on, every afternoon, if the first floor trembled, the neurosurgical operation was going on. You see, such sort of things used to happen, but most people were very helpful. There are many who used to decry. I don't think we should talk about them. We should talk about the good people. 2 more personalities I'll mention before I proceed. One was Dr. Rajagopal, V. Rajagopal, who is my classmate. He was the anesthetist. And anesthesia was very difficult, I told you, in those days. But he gradually introduced new techniques. And by 1958-59, by 8 years' time, new techniques have come and mortality began to go down. And then in the investigation field, We started angiography in Madras. I told you I started it in Newcastle. This was helped by one Dr. Pillai, Mahadevan Pillai, who was an excellent radiologist. And so with the help of these people, and one more person I should mention here is Dr. S.T. Narasimhan. He was only an LMP and a general practitioner in triplicate. In 1945, as soon as war was over, he went to New York and studied neurology and neurosurgery and came back in 48 and set up the EEG laboratory in India. First person to set up an electroencephalogram in India. In fact, he should be called the pioneer of neurosurgery, not myself or Chandy.
That was how many years ago?
2 years earlier than us, 1948. I started in 50, the department, but he was already in 1948. He had started privately, but then as soon as I came, I made the government appoint him as honorary assistant in my department. I was the paid assistant, he was the honorary assistant. And you know, he's much older than me. He was 10 years older and a grand personality. And he used to come with a bow tie to the ward. And you know, with his long coat and the bow tie, most people used to think that he was the chief. So when I used to go to examine the patient will say, "Sir, periya doctor appe vandutar sir. The big chief has already seen me. Big chief, Dr. Ramamurthy, has already come and seen me. What do you want to see me again?" So I used to keep up the joke. I said, "Is that so? Then it is all right. Don't worry." He is a real grand person, very helpful. Then he finished his MBBS, great struggle, and then he became the founder of our society also. He died suddenly from a heart attack. It is a great loss. So these are the personalities who built up this department. And one more person I must pay my tribute, that is R.G. Krishnan. He was the dean, a very farsighted person. During his regime, I got facilities given to me. So these are the things that happened.
You were talking about Dr. Vogt doing a postmortem on Lenin's brain. How did he gain access to the brain, and how was he allowed to do this?
As we all know, Lenin was the greatest figure of Russian communism in those days. And when he died, most often in the Western countries, when great people die, there is some difficulty in knowing the cause of death. Postmortem is automatically done. There is no hassle or hullabaloo about it.
Unlike in India.
So the Russian authorities invited Professor Vogt, who was the most well-known neuropathologist and anatomist of those days, to go to Moscow, and he himself did the postmortem, the entire postmortem. So after the postmortem is done, the internal organs are removed, then they preserve the body, they embalm the body, and then that is what we see in Lenin's tomb. And so I don't know if you have gone to Moscow. In Moscow there, opposite the Kremlin, there is the Lenin's tomb, which is guarded. A very interesting sight. But what the strange thing is, there is so much of resistance for postmortem in India, whereas in the West, it is a fairly accepted fact. And what is stranger is that in India, we all say this body is anityam. It is only the soul, Atma, that is important. The body ingiradhu oru satta mari, indha janmathil oru satta, adutha janmathil oru satta nu solli thooki podunga nu sollivittu, andha bodyku postmortem panna koodadhu abdingra andha attitude konjam romba kashtama irukku. Because usually in Vedic culture, the body is thrown off and it is burnt. That's all. But in cultures that bury the dead, then this problem comes. The postmortem should be allowed or not. So probably in India, this is a conflict between maybe two or three cultures that has given us this idea that postmortem is not the correct thing to do. But both from scientific point of view and historical point of view and legal point of view, whenever there is any problem, even a doubt, if postmortem had been done, then there will be no difficulty about when the person died or how the person died. So that's the importance of a postmortem. And it is not mutilating the body. The body is already gone. The soul is gone. There is no mutilation. That has to be clearly understood. And people who do the postmortem nowadays do it very carefully. And when the body is returned, it is returned in a good shape. It is not mutilated. Many people think postmortem means everything will be disfigured and all that.
But that's as a rule, postmortem is done when the cause of death is not known.
Is not known, or whether there is any dispute, or in a medico-legal case, or often in accident cases also.
But that is true in the West also?
Yes, yes. West it is compulsory. It's not only compulsory, but the public accede it without any problem. Here, there is a lot of resistance from the public. That is what is strange. So, by about 10 years' time, that is by 1960, diagnosis has improved, anesthesia improved, and the mortality, that is the risk from neurosurgery, from almost 30%, it came down to about 10%. Patients also were referred earlier.
What was the attitude of the general public to being treated? Because neurosurgery was a totally new field.
Quite right. They were scared. See, if an operation is done on the brain, on the head, head operation means death. That is the attitude of the public. So it was very difficult to convince them. So I got to sit sometimes for hours. Then you convince, say, the father and mother, then they will say yes. 2 days later, the grandmother and grandfather will come, the granduncle will come. Then you talk to them. Then somehow you convince them to get operated. And you have to tell them, if you don't operate, the patient will definitely die. If you operate, there is a chance. So gradually, the public attitude improved. Same thing with doctors. Doctors were saying there are no brain tumors. So how will they diagnose, think there are no tumors? So I've got to go on lecturing. I have gone to every district in this country, except perhaps Assam and eastern, western Gujarat, except these two. Every district in the country, from Kashmir to Kanyakumari, I have given lectures. Whoever calls me for a talk, I'll go and talk. The first 20 years up to 1970, there's no place in India I have not visited to talk about neurosurgery. That is how the attitude changed. So by 1960, we had enough facilities. I had two assistants. And 1954 itself, Dr. Bala Parameshwar Rao, who is one of the senior most neurosurgeons of the country, joined me as my student, worked for 3 years, then went back to Andhra. Then a number of people began coming in. So at that time, here I should mention about Dr. Chandy. Dr. Jacob Chandy, 10 years, 12 years senior to me. And he was working in America. Then he went to work under Penfield. Then came back and started neurosurgery in Vellore 1 year earlier than me in 1949 in the Christian Medical College. And he was very aggressive. And being outside a state institution, and without the communal virus, he was able to succeed much faster in a private institution. But that was lucky for me, because I could show the example of Chandy and his department and get things out of this government, the Madras government. You know, get things out of a government is difficult, but once it comes, it's more or less permanent. So Chandy's progress and mine matched each other, and he was able to achieve and spearhead many things, which helped me a lot. So both of us decided that we should start a postgraduate course in neurosurgery. And in 1960, we started the first postgraduate degree course under the Madras University.
Was it difficult for you to introduce the course or start an institution?
Yes, it was difficult. But you know, Sir Lakshmipathi Mudaliar was there, and then Chandy was there. He had a lot of influence with him. I was too young, you see, I was always considered too young. It is a disadvantage, but it is better to be young rather than old, I prefer that. And with Chandy's influence and my own persistence, dogging the steps of Lakshmipathi Mudaliar, going to his house. But Lakshmipathi Mudaliar had a more vision than most people, so he could appreciate. And so there was no big problem in starting it, though there are some problems. And from then on, every year we had postgraduate students, many students. In this connection, I would like to mention one artist. This artist, this was in 1956, who gradually began losing power in his limbs and could not walk. So he went to many doctors, and in those days, people never thought of any pressure on the spinal cord. They went on treating him with some medicines. Then he went to Ayurvedic specialists. Nothing happened, getting worse. Then he resigned himself to God. He is a great painter and a worshipper of Nataraja. He comes from Chidambaram. Then he went to a village Vaidya. And then he said, there is some young doctor I hear, some nerve doctor in GH, General Hospital. Why don't you go and see him? The artist said, what is the use of these doctors? They give me injection and send me off, I won't go. No, but this Vaidya persisted. No, last chance. Go and see him. He may be able to help. So this gentleman came. He came, of course, in a wheelchair. Then the first 1 minute of examination, I knew he was having a pressure on the spinal cord. See, if the paralysis is due to pressure, then we can take away the pressure. The paralysis will improve. On the other hand, if the nerve is damaged, you can't do much. Luckily, in this case, it was a pressure, and I could prove it by x-rays. Operated on him, and within 1 month, the power came back, and he was able to walk. He was so grateful. And after about 3 months, gentleman in a nice dress walks into my room, briskly, and, good morning, doctor. Yes, don't you remember me? I said, no, I don't. But your face is very familiar. Because, you know, you see patients and they are lying down when they are ill and all that. Later on, when they become all that, they are smart, you don't often recognize them. He said, I am so and so, the artist. And then he had a big parcel under his arm and he gave it to me, this is for you. So when I opened it, it is a beautiful painting of Lord Nataraja. See, the Lord of the cosmic dance, the Lord who dances on his feet. So he said, you gave me my feet, so I am giving you this.
Could this gentleman afford the fees and the...
Those days, there is no... Even today, with me, there is no question of fees. I got VHS. I treat 30 to 40 patients free in those wards. So in a general hospital of those days, everything was free. Only some people got into the special wards. Medicines were free. We were... All doctors gave free services. We didn't take any bribes. Nobody took anything. I don't remember taking any money from a patient in general hospital in... those days. There's no difficulty for people to come to general hospital to get the specialist and get his treatment. So this is an episode which certainly reminds you of the possibilities of neurosurgery. Similarly, if there is a pressure on the eye nerve, like a pituitary gland, then if you remove that pressure by, now you've got very good operations, small operations, using a microscope, and you can take it off, then the patient will begin to see. So it is said, if you can make the lame walk, and if you can make the blind see, you are a god. See, that is what happens in neurosurgery. You can make the blind see, and you can make the lame walk.
I'm sure to many people you are a god, doctor.
There's one thing I want to mention. This attitude of Indians is an excellent attitude. Vaidyo Narayano Hari. They say, sir, you are god. See, with all this consumer court business, I start explaining to my patients, you know, this is a brain operation, I'll do this, I'll do that, complication. They say, stop. We have come to you, you are a senior doctor. We know therefore case is serious. If it's not serious, we won't come to you. So don't tell us about seriousness. Tell us, is there any hope, whether you can give us any chance. So talk about that. Now in a consumer court, if you say, you must mention all the complications of the case to your patient, the patient will die from fear, from hearing the complication. So that attitude of the Indians towards doctors, that they are gods, is still prevalent in the country. The corollary is that a doctor should not betray the trust. It's very, very wrong of many doctors today, even in South India, who are betraying the patient's trust for money, do unnecessary operations, unnecessary medicines, costly medicines. It is very, very wrong. It is adharma.
And total exploitation of the patient.
It is something that cannot be tolerated in a doctor. Why do they call you God? Because you are his support in distress. And that if you capitalize and exploit, that's a great sin. We never thought of these things. Our teachers never led us in those wrong ways. How is it our students have gone into the wrong ways? I don't know. Very difficult to explain.
You were talking about the lame being able to walk by release of pressure with surgery. What about the damage caused by polio? Is it irreversible?
No, it is irreversible. Because the nerve cells are damaged, destroyed. And there is one cell in the body that cannot be replaced. That's the brain cell. Every other cell regenerates. The heart cell, the liver cell, bone cell, every other cell can regenerate. The brain cell, once it is gone, is gone. That is why head injuries are so difficult to treat.
But even so, a person who's been afflicted with polio, the rest of his brain is not affected. He functions normally.
Is absolutely normal. That is a tragedy. That's why you must prevent polio. Must prevent polio in this country. I have seen so many children afflicted with polio in my younger days, of doctor's days, professional days. But now we don't see so many. It's a great thing. Now I must go back to a story. There was this governor. This is the governor of Andhra Pradesh. This governor sent for me. I got a phone. In those days, governors were very courteous. And the governor himself phoned me and I would request you to come to Hyderabad and see me. But I was a government servant, so I always maintained good discipline with my superiors. In fact, yesterday in the Vice-Chancellor's meeting, there was a Vice-Chancellor taking over medical university. I was presiding. Then one of the senior DMEs told us about an episode about myself. I was the principal of the Madras Medical College. I did not want to become the DME. I was senior. So my junior was posted as DME. Then he came to the medical college for inspection, official. So he came, I received him and went round. And then when he was leaving my office, I went with him to the car. He said, "No, sir, you should not come." He said, "No, you are the DME. I am the principal. You are my superior officer. So it is my courtesy to take you." I went and opened the door and made him sit inside, close the door. He was my student. But that doesn't make a difference. He is your boss. Outside is entirely different. So like this, discipline. So I asked my DME and he said, "Yes, governor is." So I went there and they made me stay at the Raj Bhavan. You know, I was quite young. I was quite impressed by Raj Bhavans. And he gave me a nice dinner. And after dinner, he said, "You must have noticed something about me." I said, "Yes. You have got tremors in your hands. You are not able to take the food to your mouth properly." "Yes, that's my problem. Now, I have been operated in England on one side for this trouble. Now, the other side is giving trouble. Why can't I be operated in India? I hear you are a very good surgeon, senior surgeon. Why don't you operate?" I said, "Sir, it is a very important thing that you have asked me, because this type of surgery, which is called stereotactic surgery, it's a new surgery in 1960, is not available in this country. I have been trying to get it, but it's been very difficult to do so. It requires training." I said, "Suppose I bring those people from Britain who operated on me. They come from the London Hospital, Queen Square Hospital, best hospital in the world for neurology. And I also come to Madras. Can the operation be done there? And also you can teach others and you can learn." I said, "Fine, that will be excellent." And you know what he did? He picked up the phone, called Jawaharlal Nehru. It was about 11:05 p.m. Got him on the phone, talked to Panditji, and he said, "This is the problem. I am Professor Ramamurthy is here, and I am telling him that we will bring a team, and it will not be very costly. It can go under the Commonwealth help." He said, "Yes, why don't you go ahead?" That's what the Prime Minister said. And immediately, next morning I left. I said, "Thank you, sir." He said, "You don't worry, I'll make all the arrangements. We'll be in touch with you." This was General Srinagesh. He was the governor of Andhra Pradesh. And within 1 month, I had communication from the neurologists and neurosurgeons of London. And then they came. They came to Madras. And they stayed 3 weeks. They brought all the equipment with them. They brought their nurse also. And they did about 20 operations. Say, we collected newspaper information. So people came from Gujarat, Delhi, everywhere. We collected patients, selected them and operated with good results. And then the Srinagesh also was operated. That set us on the way to become one of the world's best stereotactic centers. We set it up in Madras.
He was operated in Madras.
Yeah. From 1960 to 1978, we did 2,000 operations of this type, where you don't make a big opening in the skull, make only a small fine tube opening, pass a small needle inside and touch the whichever part is diseased and destroy it or put medicine. This is useful for what's called Parkinsonism, you know, the movements, some mental disorders, some very painful disorders. For all this, it is useful.
And did he recover, the governor?
Oh, yes. He came back and then he was there for 3 more years. Then he retired. And these are the landmarks. You know how sometimes luck or God's grace or what you would like to call it plays a part and then makes you just take off in an excellent direction.